Welcome to the eLearn Security video training. In this lesson, we will see some advanced techniques that will allow us to map the internal network of an organization from a machine that we have previously exploited. The goal is to get access to the target organization core assets. In order to achieve our goal, we might have to perform the exploitation of multiple machines in the remote network. In this video, we will use this scenario. We already have an interpreter session on victim 1, so what we will do is scan the internal network. In this case, the 192.168.5.0 subnet, and search for other possible targets. Through host discovery techniques, we will find that host 192.168.5.5, and we will call that victim number 2. Since we can't access it directly from the internet, we will use the already open session on victim 1 as a bridge. This technique is called pivoting. Once we have our route to victim 2, we will try to exploit it. Once the exploit is executed, we will create a new interpreter session on victim 2. Note that all the traffic goes from interpreter session on victim 1 to victim 2. At this point, we should start over the post-exploitation process for this machine from the privilege escalation to data harvesting. We will try to find a connection from victim 2 to another host that resides in another subnet that is a DMZ. We will discover that only victim 2 is able to communicate with the DMZ, so we will use again the pivoting technique on the host in order to attack the mail server from victim 2. Then our route will start from the attacker machine on victim 1, from victim 1 to victim 2, and then from victim 2 to the DMZ. This is similar to what happens in a real-world scenario, although simplified in the steps needed to arrive to the DMZ. Once you learn the post-exploitation methodology, you will be able to apply it in a real-world case, no matter how many hosts you have to compromise. Now that we have the scenario, we can start a post-exploitation process. This is our attacker machine on which we have our interpreter session on victim 1. So the first step is to scan the victim subnet in order to find other hosts. Let's see the IP address of the exploited machine with the ipconfig command. One of the host discovery techniques that we can use is the ARP scan. Here we can try to scan the class C 192.168.5.0 or the B class 192.168.0.0 and so on. In our case, we will try to ARP scan the B class to see what happens on victim 1. So let's see which options we can use with the ARP scanner module. As you can see, we can set the IP range to scan with the minus R option. So let's set the B class this way. Run ARP scanner minus R 192.168.0.0/16. The scan is started, so let's see what happens on victim 1. As you can see in Wireshark, victim 1 is sending a lot of ARP requests in the network to see who responds with an ARP reply. As you can imagine, this task will take a lot of time and a lot of traffic, especially if you can scan the whole B class. Most of the times you might want to use the C class, as it is really uncommon to have a broadcast domain being the entire B class. Let's stop the ARP scanner and see what we've got so far. As you can see from the results, we found another host on the same subnet as the exploited machine. Besides the .1, that is probably the router interface, and the .255, that is the broadcast address. Let's then try to get some information about the new host running a port scan. Metasploit has a module that allows us to scan other hosts through an interpreter session. Since we can't directly reach the host, then we should use the exploited machine as a bridge between us and victim 2. So it will be victim 1 to scan victim 2, and our IP address will not appear in the logs of victim 2, although it surely appears in victim 1's logs. Let's first see what happens if we port scan victim 2 without configuring the bridge. To perform a TCP scan, we can use the following module: Auxiliary Scanner Port Scan TCP. Now let's set the remote host in our case, it's victim 2, and the IP address is 192.168.5.5. Let's say we want to scan only the first 1024 ports, so let's set up ports option and set it from 1 to 1024. The module is now configured. Let's try to execute it and see if we get any results. As you can see, we are getting no results. Let's see then if something is happening on the victim machine. As you can see from Wireshark on victim 1, there is no trace of port scan being made, meaning that something is missing. What's missing is a route to victim 2 through victim 1, so that every time we want to reach victim 2, Metasploit knows we want to use the tunnel for this traffic through victim 1. To add a route, we can simply use auto route module in Metasploit. So let's use it this way. Use post windows manage auto route. Let's see which options we have to configure before running the module. Here we can set the route command, the net mask, the session, and the subnet. The CMD and netmask options are fine as they are. We need to configure the session and the subnet, so let's write set session 1, that is the session on victim 1, and then set subnet 192.168.5.0, so the module should now be configured. Let's run it. The script confirms that a new route has been created. We can check it also with the route print command. Now we should be able to use the session on victim 1 as a bridge to send commands to victim 2. This is also called pivoting and is an essential part of post-exploitation techniques. Let's then now run again the port scan and see what happens this time. The module is set up the same way as before, so let's run it and see if we get something this time. As you can see, after a few seconds we get the first results. The tool is working fine and the victim 2 is being scanned. So to clarify what's happening, let's see the traffic on victim 1. As you can see in Wireshark, victim 1 is performing the scan on victim 2 for us. Also note that there is no direct connection between us and victim 2. All the traffic goes through the interpreter session on victim 1. This is how pivoting works. Going back to our machine, we can see the list of open ports on the victim. So what can we do now? We will want to exploit this machine in some way. In this case, we will try to use the MS-08-067 vulnerability and see if we are successful. Let's set the exploit and configure it. Here we have to set the rhosts. Since we have our route, we can directly specify the victim 2 IP address. This should be fine, so let's run the exploit. As you can see, the exploit started, discovered that the machine runs Windows XP, but as you can read from the results, no session was created. This means that the machine could be patched, and then we have to use another attack vector to gain access on the victim. So thinking about network configuration and Windows users found in the first victim, there's a chance that we can use the pass the hash technique. This technique uses the password hash of an existing user to get access on another machine that shared the same user and of course the same password. The beauty of this attack is that we don't even need to crack the password. We only need that a user on the machine for which we have the hashes has access to another machine. This is common in many networks with system administrators using the same credentials over a number of machines for which they have to perform maintenance. So let's go back to our victim 1 machine and check the users and their hashes with the hash dump command. Here it is, the list. We could try all of them and check if we got lucky. For now, let's start with netadmin, so let's copy the password hash and go back to MSF. Now we have to select the psexec module. In order to do that, we can type use exploit windows smb psexec. Let's see which options we need to set. So here again, the rhost will be set to 192.168.5.5. The user will be netadmin. And the password is the hash that we have just copied from victim 1. Now we can leave the rest as it is and try the exploit. In this case, if the exploit works and the victim 2 has access to the internet, it will directly connect back to us. As you can see, we've got an interpreter session on victim 2 that is a reverse shell to our attacking machine. So what if we don't want the victim 2 to directly connect back to us because use the victim 1 as the attacking machine? The only thing we have to do is to set the local host option on the module to IP address of victim 1. So let's reconfigure the module to get us a reverse shell to victim 1. As you can see, victim 2 started the reverse shell to victim 1, and since we already have a session on victim 1, a new interpreter session has been created. As you can imagine, all the traffic in this section will go through victim 1. Again, this technique is useful if our victim can't directly connect back to us. So now that we have completed the exploitation phase on this new host, we can start our post-exploitation process in order to escalate privileges, maintain access, harvest data, and then check for other hosts reachable from this one. By now you should already know how to do this, so let's assume that we have accomplished these tasks already and that during the network exploitation phase we discovered we have access to new hosts. Indeed, running the netstat command on the exploited machine, we discover POP3 and IMAP connections to a host into a different subnet. Here's the IP address of the host in that subnet. So why didn't we discover that host while performing the ARP scan on the Class B network? Simply because ARP requests are sent and broadcast, and this new host belongs to a different broadcast domain, being the 192.168.4.0 subnet. So now that we know the IP address of this host, let's try to ping it from victim 1. Let's enter victim 1 session and try to ping the new target. As you can see, the host is unreachable. Let's see what happens if we ping the new host from victim 2 instead. Let's get into the victim 2 interpreter shell first. Now we try to ping the new host. And as you can see, victim 2 is allowed to communicate with the new host. So we found a new machine and a new subnet that is reachable only from victim 2. At this point, we could try to scan the new 4.0 subnet from victim 2 in order to discover other hosts in that subnet. We will skip this step since you already know how to do it, and we will instead scan ports on the remote system. Remember that we first need a new route to this new subnet. So let's go back to the Metasploit console and select the Auto Route module. This time the subnet to reach is 192.168.4.0, and we do it through victim 2 interpreter session that is session number 3. Let's run the module and verify that the new route has been added. Now we have two routes to two internal subnets on the target organization. Let's move on to the actual port scan of the final target. Let's select the port scanner module and then let's set the remote host. As you can see, it is working fine. On victim 2, we see the traffic going from the exploited machine to the new target. So again, all the traffic passes from victim 2 to the new host. Going back to our attacking machine, we see the list of open ports. As you can remember, victim 2 was connected to this new host on port 110. We can confirm that this server has port 110 open and acts mostly like a mail server for the internal organization. So again, what we can do now is to try to get access to the server repeating the exploitation phase. We will use the route created from victim 1 to victim 2 to attack this new host that is a server and that we will call victim 3. Note that as we as an external attacker, we do not have direct access to victim 3 because it is a firewalled server accessible only from subnets within the internal network. We have seen that victim 3 is most probably running Windows since ports 139 and 445 were open. So let's try the MS08067 module. Let's select the module and set the remote host. If the machine is vulnerable, we should be able to exploit it and gain a shell. So let's run the module and see what happens. As you can see, the module and the exploit is completed against a Windows Server 2003 SP1 machine, but there's no interpreter session for us. Since this is a mail server, there is a high chance that the server is protected by a firewall, meaning that maybe not all of the outgoing connections are allowed from the server. The fact that the exploit completed without a session might be due to a rule in the firewall preventing our payload to connect back to us. So what we can try doing is change the local port on the Metasploit module and use one of the ports that we have found open during the port scan. The selection of the port to use is highly dependent on the services installed on the server and for which a firewall rule will allow traffic. For example, if you find out that Microsoft Exchange is installed on the server, you can use Google to look up which ports this service uses for ingoing and outgoing traffic and try with any of these ports. In this case, let's try with port 110 and then set the L port to 110. The server is supposed to only listen on that port, but according to how the firewall rule is written, it might also be allowed by mistake to initiate a connection to another host on that port. We can now run the exploit again and verify if this time it works. As you can see, after a few seconds we have an interpreter shell, and this time it worked fine. So again, now we can start over the entire process of post-exploitation once again for the newly exploited machine. In this case, we exploited a mail server. You can imagine which kind of information you might be able to find while harvesting data. In the same subnet, we could also have more servers to exploit, as this is supposed to be a DMZ. At this point, you should have the necessary understanding of the methodology and tools involved during the post-exploitation phase of small as well as large corporate networks. That concludes this video training.